The Death of Ivan Ilyich by Leo Tolstoy, read by Oliver Ford Davis. Chapter 1. During an interval in the Melvinsky trial in the large building of the law courts, the members and public prosecutor met in Ivan Egorovich Shebek's private room, where the conversation turned on the celebrated Krasovsky case. Fyodor Vasilievich warmly maintained that it was not subject to their jurisdiction. Ivan Egorovich maintained the contrary, while Pyotr Ivanovich, not having entered into the discussion at the start, took no part in it but looked through the Gazette, which had just been handed in. "Gentlemen," he said, "Ivan Ilyich has died."
"You don't say so."
"Here, read it yourself," replied Pyotr Ivanovich, handing Fyodor Vasilievich the paper still damp from the press. Surrounded by a black border were the words, "Praskovya Fyodorovna Golovina, with profound sorrow, informs relatives and friends of the demise of her beloved husband, Ivan Ilyich Golovin, member of the Court of Justice, which occurred on February the 4th of this year, 1882. The funeral will take place on Friday at 1 o'clock in the afternoon." Ivan Ilyich had been a colleague of the gentlemen present and was liked by them all. He had been ill for some weeks with an illness said to be incurable. His post had been kept open for him, but there had been conjectures that in case of his death, Alexeyev might receive his appointment, and that either Vinnikov or Stabel would succeed Alexeyev. So, on receiving the news of Ivan Ilyich's death, the first thought of each of the gentlemen in that private room was of the changes and promotions it might occasion among themselves or their acquaintances. "I shall be sure to get Stabel's place or Vinnikov's," thought Fyodor Vasilievich. "I was promised that long ago, and the promotion means an extra 800 rubles a year for me, besides the allowance. Now, I must apply for my brother-in-law's transfer from Kaluga," thought Pyotr Ivanovich. "My wife will be very glad, and then she won't be able to say that I never do anything for her relations."
"I thought he would never leave his bed again," said Pyotr Ivanovich aloud. "It's very sad."
But what really was the matter with him?
The doctors couldn't say. At least they could, but each of them said something different. "When I last saw him, I thought he was getting better. And I haven't been to see him since the holidays. I always meant to go."
"Had he any property?"
"I think his wife had a little, but something quite trifling."
"We shall have to go and see her, but they live so terribly far away."
"Far away from you, you mean? Everything's far away from your place."
"You see, he never can forgive my living on the other side of the river," said Pyotr Ivanovich, smiling at Shebek. Then, still talking of the distances between different parts of the city, they returned to the court.
Besides considerations as to the possible transfers and promotions likely to result from Ivan Ilyich's death, the mere fact of the death of a near acquaintance aroused, as usual, in all who heard of it, the complacent feeling that it is he who is dead and not I. Each one thought or felt, "Well, he's dead, but I'm alive." But the more intimate of Ivan Ilyich's acquaintances, his so-called friends, could not help thinking also that they would now have to fulfill the very tiresome demands of propriety by attending the funeral service and paying a visit of condolence to the widow. Fyodor Vasilievich and Pyotr Ivanovich had been his nearest acquaintances. Pyotr Ivanovich had studied law with Ivan Ilyich and had considered himself to be under obligations to him. Having told his wife at dinner time of Ivan Ilyich's death and of his conjecture that it might be possible to get her brother transferred to their circuit, Pyotr Ivanovich sacrificed his usual nap, put on his evening clothes, and drove to Ivan Ilyich's house.
At the entrance stood a carriage and two cabs. Leaning against the wall in the hall downstairs, near the cloak stand, was a coffin lid covered with cloth of gold, ornamented with gold cord and tassels that had been polished up with metal powder. Two ladies in black were taking off their fur cloaks.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.